Adventures come in all shapes and sizes. Some are grand and life-changing, others more humble and altruistic. But they all require a daring spirit and a desire to try something new. I'm Aaron Baker. Join us for our own journey today through stories that all share a common spirit. We'll kick off our adventure in Pittsburgh, where Chris Lovingood from WTAE has the scoop on one man's mission around the world.
When you hear about a trip that's 40,000 miles by plane, you may be thinking to yourself, that's a long time to be seated. And yet, that is a trip that Ross Edmondson has decided to take, not just because it's a personal goal of his, but also because he's doing it for charity.
It's been a dream of mine ever since I started getting interested in aircraft, back when I was about 13, 14 years old.
And now, he's on a journey from the Zelianopol Municipal Airport to fulfill that dream in his majestically named aircraft.
I'm standing in front of Planey McPlaneface.
Told you. Edmondson says he's made long trips before, but this is his first world trip by plane, one he plans to put to good use.
With a trip like this comes an opportunity to do some good and bring some awareness. Obviously, I'm talking to you now, a little bit of publicity. So we decided to adopt the charity African Promise.
He says the charity supports primary education in Kenya. Seven primary schools they tend to are provided extra teachers and school supplies. Every dime he raises through his website during the trip goes to that cause.
And what made you want to take such a strenuous flight?
Since whenever I started flying, I've loved the idea of doing long distance flights and seeing new places.
Many new places across five continents, with the occasional nerve-wracking moment while up there.
There's a corny old saying that says flying is 99% boredom punctuated by 1% moments of terror. Hopefully there'll be none of those 1% on this trip.
Edmondson says people have told him his flight in his specific aircraft is impossible. But to that he says, he doesn't care.
If people are telling you, well, I don't think this is possible, it's too hard, you should probably not give it a go, maybe don't listen to them straight away and give it a go anyway.
Some good advice there from Ross, and good news too. Over 80,000 miles later, he safely completed his trip. Speaking of flying, one Sacramento woman is helping astronauts prepare for their travels out of this world, all from the comfort of Earth. KCRA's Heather Waldman has the story.
As a young child, I had a Lego set, and I pretended for days and weeks to be a Martian colonist.
And now, Alyssa Shannon, a Sacramento area resident and lifelong adventurer, is going to pretend to be on Mars for real. She was selected out of thousands of applicants to be one of four analog astronauts for NASA's Crew Health and Performance Exploration Analog.
It's a 378-day mission.
Where she and her crewmates will live, work, and create in this habitat.
Well, it's a 1,700-square-foot habitat that's been 3D printed.
Alyssa will serve as the science officer, working in a mini lab and improvising around various communication challenges, simulating what it could be like to spend an entire year on the Martian surface.
We're going to be eating a Mars realistic spaceflight food system.
So, no outside food.
Honestly, I think I'm going to miss Fritos a great deal.
And forget about packing your entire closet.
Even deciding on simple, like which t-shirt, when you can only have so many t-shirts for a full year.
And very limited communication with other Earthlings. For the last few weeks, she's been prepping meals for her partner, making adjustments at work, even pausing her phone service.
There's a lot of challenges when getting ready to shut down your life for a year.
But despite the challenges, Alyssa is motivated by a childhood dream and a passion for science.
I think the most exciting part for me is when we actually do land on Mars and 10, 15, 20 years in the future, and knowing that I helped us in my own small way.
Well, hopefully we'll see a Mars landing in our lifetimes. Brittany Decker talks to a traveler in Alabama who's breaking all kinds of records.
I think anyone can do anything.
Four passports, four Guinness World Records.
I traveled to every country in the world over the span of 18 months.
You can trek with Taylor through a highlight reel of pictures that shows off her journey to all 196 countries.
I met incredible people in places a lot of people probably have never even heard of, and in places that, you know, we might not hear overly positive things about.
You may be wondering, how did she do it? After an internship on Wall Street, Taylor realized a passion for travel outweighed her former career ambition for investment banking. So she got started,
3 weeks after graduation.
Work every day to get, it's like a giant puzzle, but the pieces like were constantly changing too, because countries could change their, you know, visa requirements just any day.
Lots of spreadsheets, hundreds to thousands of emails, many explaining her mission and earning hotel sponsors. And most of the travel she did alone, but she had her family's support along the way, including at the finish line in Canada.
I learned more into past 2 years than I ever have in my entire life and probably ever will. You might not look the same or have the same religion or speak the same language, but that's really for me the biggest thing that I took away, and also just how kind everyone is.
And now, after this whirlwind of an adventure, what's next for this 24-year-old?
That's a good question.
What a jet setter. After the break, we have more stories from brave adventurers who specialize in reuniting people with their missing belongings. Welcome back. Now we're bringing you a story of lost and found memories in Maryland. Kai Reed at WBAL tells us more.
My wife and I went to Hawaii on our 35th wedding anniversary trip of a lifetime. And we had so much fun, but this is like one last adventure that we would just love to complete.
Jerry McNamara came back from his Hawaiian vacation with a lot of his own memories. But he also came back with a lot of someone else's. A family, a mom, dad, and two kids, apparently from Maryland, lost a GoPro camera while on vacation. Jerry found it and is determined to get it back to them.
I had 6 hours of video and pictures on my GoPro. If I had lost that, I would have been absolutely heartbroken. So to do unto others what you have them do unto you, I thought, let's get these memories back to this family. I think it'll mean a lot to them.
Jerry thinks the family went to Molokini, a popular spot near Maui, where he found the camera while snorkeling. It appears they rented a Jeep on the trip. At one point, the little girls named Ellie and Macy mentioned the time change from Maryland.
They say sweet things like, oh, my sister was so brave today. She swam really far. And it's just that kind of thing. Like, you would want to have that for, you know, a lifetime. To just remember those kind of moments.
Another video shows the dad running in the Savage Race in Kennedyville, about an hour and a half from Baltimore.
Although you never see him in that mudder race, he has the camera mounted on his chest. When people talk to him, hey man, you know, that kind of stuff, it sounds like somebody calls him Danny. And so I'm hoping that can be a clue.
Jerry reached out to GoPro, and the camera, a black Hero 9 model, hasn't been reported missing.
I feel like I'm doing everything I can because I so want them to have their memories back, like I know I would want someone to do for our family. I think our stories tell so much about who we are as people, and here's the chapter of the story they're not gonna have. But if they get this back, then they will always have that memory.
You'll be happy to know Jerry was able to find the owner of the camera in Hartford County, Maryland. Now KNBC's Bianca Beltran has the story of a very special lost and found in Missouri.
A lucky find on a fishing trip with her dad at Lake Annette.
She's digging around in the dirt, and I happen to look down and see a shiny little circle in the mud.
A Belton High School ring, class of 1967, with the initials BH. Amanda's dad cleaned it up and put it away. 30 years later, she came across it helping him move. She posted it on Facebook, and within an hour, she had her answer.
Are you Jim? I'm Amanda. Oh, we're gonna hug.
Okay. Oh. Nice to meet you.
I got something for you.
The ring belonged to Jim's brother, Bill Huffman.
Man, that's unbelievable.
Bill lost the ring, saving his friend from drowning at the lake.
I guess the water was so cold that he lost his ring.
A story they talked about for years.
He had a love of adventure. He tried hot air ballooning, but that took too many people to do. He tried skydiving, and he said that got over too fast.
Bill took up hand gliding, and he soared for years until he died in an accident.
He lived each day to its fullest. I don't think I've ever known anybody that did that.
Bill had just turned 40, and it happened to be the same year Amanda found that ring.
Maybe I was meant to find it that day and hold on to it all this time and find the owner and bring it to them in the perfect moment.
It's just fate, you know. It's really something. God works in mysterious ways.
When people go on adventures, they tend to lose some important items in the excitement of the moment. Add water to that equation, and it's a recipe for disaster. KCRA's Jason Marks has a story on one California man helping those unlucky travelers.
When you're 119 miles long and you twist and turn from the Sierra Nevada down to Sacramento, you most likely provide a few stories to tell.
The American River is just a jewel for Sacramento.
Carl Bly has created his own tale.
I've done everything you can do to enjoy the river.
Bly might very well have the most recognizable face on the river, complete with his own nickname.
AR Kayaker. I used to just go by A Kayaker, but a lot of people do that. So AR Kayaker for American River Kayaker.
But as you're about to see, this kayaker who has no cape is a superhero in his own right.
That water goes fast. It tumbles you. You don't know whether you're up or down.
Spending his days helping those who find out the river.
He's amazing.
Can be equally beautiful and dangerous.
I hang out here at the rapids and I'll help people out, you know, help them get to shore.
Their stuff above the water. But Bly's superpower lies in gathering what's below it.
If it's a common thing brought on the river, then it's a common thing found in the river. I will lean over the back of this boat and I will just watch the bottom of the river go by.
It's an art that he's perfected over the past 40 years.
This is like a never-ending treasure hunt for me. There's Easter eggs to find everywhere, always. You name it, if somebody brings it on the river, they're gonna lose it eventually.
If Carl Bly is Batman, then Matt Sprutenberg has to be Robin.
All right, here we go. Found this magnet, found a bank card, a margarita can. I've never seen one like that before, pinkies up. I found somebody's Apple Watch.
Yeah, that's all I got.
That's a decent day. Look at that pile.
Together, they scour the river's bottom, never knowing what treasures they'll find.
You look for stuff in the river, you find stuff in the river, that's an adventure. But then it's a whole new level of adventure to try to find the owners.
It's so important to him. He created the American River Lost and Found Facebook page, where he posts his daily haul.
In the past, I'd have to go through the phone book if I had a name, but now I just put a name out there and somehow magically 20,000 followers help out.
And more often than not, there's a reunion.
I don't want people to go away, you know, bummed out that they had a bad day, they lost their phone or their wallet or something. You know, like, if I can find it, I'll return it to them.
Thank you, American River Lost and Found!
After the break, adventurous globetrotters take to the road in search of new experiences. Welcome back to our journey through great adventures. Now on to California, where one pup is set to do some serious exploring. KCRA's Mike Carroll has the story.
This is Chella, a border collie who came into the world 14 years ago in Loomis, where Katie Lezak first met her when she was a veterinary assistant.
She needed to have surgery, and the owner at the time had mentioned that she was just a ranch dog and that he didn't want to invest on her.
But Katie had an uncle with a ranch in Costa Rica who paid for Chella's surgery and took her.
Well, at the very, very beginning, she was my father's dog, but, you know, I think she just liked me more than my father, and she ended up being my dog.
Now Chella is back in California and getting a checkup from Dr. Lezak.
She looks great.
A good thing, because Chella is only halfway on her journey to the Arctic Circle with Dr. Lezak's cousin, Nore Gomez. Nore has worked with Land Rover in Costa Rica, which is helping to fund this 12,000-mile adventure in this custom camper that Nore built.
Or I designed it to be very capable off-road to reach those remote places.
Nore wanted to bring Chella on this journey because he had concerns about her getting depression during the 8 months that he would be away from Costa Rica.
I am concerned with her health every month. I think she's better here than back at home.
In addition to Chella are two more dogs, a father and daughter that Nore is also taking to the northernmost regions of Canada and Alaska.
I was a little surprised when he said he was bringing Chella, And then I was a lot more surprised when he said he was bringing all three.
I don't really feel alone with them.
But they're very well-behaved dogs.
They still have more than 2,000 miles to get to the Arctic Circle, and then another 6,000 miles back to Costa Rica.
Now on to Florida, where WESH's Scott Heidler reports on a strange new kind of commercial space travel.
Imagine lifting off for a trip into space at 12 miles an hour and with a glass of wine in your hand.
So I think when most people think about space flight, they think about high Gs and floating around and discomfort, and you're in a small capsule. At least a lot of people do.
Spaceship Neptune, a vastly different craft, soon to be taking humans to the edge of space.
For us, it's this incredibly gentle flight. If you can get on a commercial airline, you can get on this. We have a bar on board. There's a loo. It's a space lounge.
The space tourist startup set up shop on its own campus next to the Titusville airport.
It is the center of where human spaceflight history was forged. It's an incredible place to have in our backyard. There's amazing employment base here.
Space Perspective now has 130 employees. Once it gets closer to taking passengers on the first flight, both capsules and balloons are manufactured here. The balloons made in a 700-foot-long custom facility.
As it goes up through the atmosphere, it expands. And so by the time it's at altitude, it's filled out the entire balloon. And now the balloon, instead of being long and skinny, is more or less round. And it's actually the size of a small football stadium.
Once passengers start to fly, they'll arrive a day or two before the trip. That'll start by boarding the company's vessel, MS Voyager.
Imagine it's really dark out. It's really awesome, beautiful stars. You'll get into Spaceship Neptune right on the deck of the ship. Then it will be released from the deck as the balloon then lifts the entire capsule incredibly gently up to space.
The trip up, about 2 hours.
Then you'll have roughly 2 hours in space to look over Florida, our incredibly beautiful Earth, over the Keys, over the Bahamas. Then you'll start a very gradual and slow descent. It takes you about another 2 hours to come back down.
Then splashdown, the capsule picked up out of the water and placed back on the ship. Launch and splashdown only about 50 miles apart, this after traveling about 20 miles up.
With tickets costing more than $100,000, the passengers will come from an elite slice of the market. But the company looks to expand that over time. Once they fly more flights and build more balloons, they look to open it to a larger customer base.
Certainly over time, we anticipate bringing the price down. Now, the truth is that the market is so vibrant that it's probably going to take us a little while.
Almost 1,200 tickets already sold, nearly half of those complete capsule buyouts. With big windows, the largest windows ever flown to space.
From the apogee of the flight, you're going to be able to see roughly 450 miles in each direction.
The craft and balloon have redundant safety measures, including 4 parachutes.
What's exciting is that the balloon technology itself has been flown thousands of times. And in the last couple of decades, there hasn't been a single in-flight failure with one of these kinds of balloons.
While Florida is Space Perspective's home, the company is looking to take it on the road down the line so others can see their slice of the world in a new light from space.
It really puts it into perspective, seeing something you recognize, which is also why we want to be able to fly from different parts of the world.
Now for our final story of the episode, Nauku Funyama with WCVB has a tale of strength and perseverance from one runner.
For Bobby Gibb, running is about feeling the world around her.
I just wanted to experience life, and this running was a time when I felt that life force of the universe.
The ground under her feet, the freshness of the ocean breeze, the sounds of the trees.
Love the sense of the world kind of whirling by, and it's like this universal flow of energy.
But back in her 20s, running represented much more to Bobby, a way to knock down the barriers that women faced. In 1966, the Winchester native applied to run in the Boston Marathon, back then an all-men's race, but got a letter back saying,
women are not physiologically able to run marathon distances. We can't take the medical liability. I crumpled it up and threw it away.
She decided in that moment that she would find a way, any way, to run the Boston Marathon. She was living in San Diego, got herself home, convinced her initially reluctant mother to drive her to the start line, and told her,
"Do this that people think is impossible. It's going to throw into question all the other misconceptions and false beliefs about women."
Once she got to Hopkinton, she ran around town for 40 minutes to warm up and also find a place where she could sneak into the race.
She eventually found some forsythia bushes not too far from the start line where she was able to hide and then jump into the race pack. She was wearing her brother's Bermuda shorts, boy sneakers, and a hoodie to try to disguise herself. After a while, the runners around her did figure it out, but they were thrilled to have her there.
At first, they didn't realize I was a woman, and then I could feel the studious silence behind me. And I could hear the guys behind me talking, "Is that a girl? Is that a girl?" And I turn around and they go, "It is a woman. Wow, this is fantastic." And this is the kind of country I love to run.
Bobby went on to have a working career, which not many women had back in those days, as a lawyer and later as an artist. She continues to create paintings and sculptures today. Now at 80 years old, she also continues to run as much as 10 miles through local trails and on the beach. But you see a lot of her running journey in her artwork, because for her, it was always about the world she saw along the way.
When I run, I really feel, I still do when I'm racing down the beach, like, wow, I'm alive, I'm alive.
What an achievement. Thank you so much for joining us today and sharing in these stories of brave travelers. I hope you caught an adventurous spirit. Until next time, I'm Aaron Baker.